Welcome to this wonderful event. I'm Reggie Fils-Aimé, and I'm sure at this point you're wondering, what is the former president and chief operating officer of Nintendo of America doing at a Microsoft Xbox event? I don't know why I'm here either. But other than I'm here with a wonderful collection of executives, people I call my friends, people that I competed against fiercely, but also people that I worked hand in glove to do a number of wonderful things in the industry. And it's a great group, and I'm sure that you will enjoy the conversation that we're going to have. We're going to talk about creativity. We're going to talk about all of the interesting things being done, not only in the gaming space, but in the variety of different things that that the panelists here are working on. And with that, let's introduce our panelists. And I'm going to start all the way over here with my friend, Bonnie Ross. Bonnie, tell us a little bit about yourself and introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Bonnie Ross. I'm the head of 343 Industries, which is the Xbox studio that does all things Halo.
That's great. Thank you. Peter.
Hi, I'm Peter Moore. I'm the former corporate vice president of interactive entertainment here at Microsoft.
Ed.
My name is Ed Fries. I'm the former vice president of Microsoft Game Studios.
Robbie.
Hi, I'm Robbie Bach, and I got rid of the corporate titles and just called myself chief Xbox officer when I was here.
That's great. Well, welcome. I think this is going to be a fabulous conversation, and we're going to get right into it. And so, you know, I personally believe that creativity and innovation are the lifeblood of this games industry. And certainly, I look back with a lot of pride on all of the innovation that I was part of, whether it was the Nintendo DS with two screens, touchscreen, first touchscreen mass market device in the consumer electronics space, the work that I did with the Wii. And I have to sneak it in, during that generation, the Wii was the top-selling console. I just had to.
Oh, it started. Are we going to talk dollars or units, Reggie?
I always talk units. Always talk units.
Shipped or sold through?
Sold through. Always sold.
We're going to edit all the Nintendo stuff out.
And obviously the work I did with the Switch. But really, you know, we need to open up and get perspective on how you feel about innovation in the space and what's going on. And you know, with that, I'm going to start with Robbie, you know, the chief commercial officer. I'd love to, and the audience would love to hear innovation and creativity from your perspective as things were getting started.
Yeah, so when we got started with Xbox, I mean, I was clearly the business guy. I mean, I used to work on Microsoft Office, for crying out loud. So I was the business guy, but I didn't think that meant we weren't supposed to be creative. And when I think about back on those early days, Xbox Live was clearly creative from a development perspective and a community perspective, but it's also super creative from a business perspective. The idea that people were going to pay $49 a year to have a subscription. Think about how many subscription services you had in 2002. The answer would be maybe a cell phone and your cable service. And that's about it. And those are closer to utilities. So Xbox was really trying to drive some real innovation in the business model. And whenever I talk about innovation, I do talk about consumer experience and technology, but I always talk about business because I think it really does matter and it affects all the other things that we did.
That's great. And then, you know, so that's the business model, obviously the innovation and creativity from the software standpoint. And that's where Ed and Bonnie, that's where you guys were involved really at the very beginning. And so, Ed, let's start with you and how you saw innovation and creativity, especially in that transition from what was happening in PC games to then console games.
Right, yeah. I mean, basically, after working at Microsoft for 10 years, I got a chance to do my dream job, which was come over and run the games group at the company. I had gotten into computers by making games when I was a kid in high school, and I was a huge player of games. So to have that be my business, super, you know, was a dream come true. But, you know, we weren't really, you know, our job was to go out and find the best people. You know, we looked all over the world to find the most creative game makers and try to sign them up to be on our team, first on PC and then as we transitioned into Xbox.
That's great. And Bonnie, you were making games at that point.
Yeah, no, we were working on PC games and, yeah, it was definitely a huge change, I would say, We were working only on PC games, and then basically Ed told us to keep doing our day job, and then we were also going to be doing Xbox games at the same time. And what I think is so funny back there is none of us questioned it. We were just like, all right, we'll do that.
24 hours in the day.
Exactly, and it was a very short amount of time. But we all just started making games for consoles.
You know, so as we were getting ready for this, you know, we got together, we told some stories, and I heard the story of when you first heard about this crazy little adventure called Xbox. I think the fans would love to hear that.
Well, obviously, I heard things, we were discussing it, and but when I actually formally found out about it was during a social event at a bar called The Garage, where Jay Allard was there just socially, and he's like, hey, I just got this job, I'm gonna run the new console business, and like, we should meet next week, because I'd love to hear more about the games we're working on and everything. That was the first I'd heard about it, like drinking a beer at the bar, that we actually were formally doing it.
It's not from your boss.
Yeah, exactly.
And, you know, even at that point, I think you both remarked that, you know, how you all saw the types of games that would be brought to bear on Xbox would be different than what was going on in the current environment. Ed, why don't you talk about that?
I'd say that slowly dawned on us. You know, at first, I thought, oh, we'll just take all these great PC franchises we have. We can take Flight Simulator and Age of Empires. We'll just port them over. Pretty quickly, we realized that just wasn't going to work. And we needed to find new teams, and we needed to learn about a new audience and make things for the console world. But we didn't really want to give up what we loved about PC and PC gaming. We loved the multiplayer. We loved, you know, the action. We loved just, you know, the biggest and best console games in the world at that time came from Japan. And I'm still a huge fan of Japan. But where was the Western content in the console world? And so I felt like we had a chance to not just imitate this arcade style, but to bring something new to bear.
So at this point, you're beginning to woo different developers, different publishers to come on the system. Peter, at that point, you were at Sega.
Yep.
And so I'd love to get your perspective at that point. You know, there's this new platform coming out. What did you think?
Well, if you recall, the Dreamcast had a Windows operating system, CE, and so we were already had a strong relationship via John Smith was our account manager at Xbox, and we were starting to get together, and the concept of online gaming, of course, the Dreamcast was the first online console, albeit 56K dial-up board modem, which was great until your mom picked up the phone in the other room and whatever you were playing disconnected. But we had started to build a rapport with my soon-to-be colleagues up here in Redmond and started to bring together the two consoles with the synergy of online being the real key and this concept of social gaming, which, and no disrespect to the Nintendo's and Sony's at that time, but they were still seeing it very much you versus me, boys in the bedrooms, on the couch.
Couch gaming.
Yeah. And to the credit, and Robbie and Ed, and maybe Bonnie will remember Okawa-san, he had this vision, was the owner of Sega, had this vision that online was going to be the future. And the Dreamcast was ahead of its time, and it, you know, it sadly didn't quite make it in the face of the impending PlayStation fudding, fear, uncertainty, and doubt that came along, and they did it brilliantly.
No bitterness on your part, Peter.
None whatsoever. It's only 20 odd years ago, and I'm still
let
angry.
Let it go.
But I think that, you know, as the Dreamcast unfortunately faded into the sunset, the baton was passed to Xbox, and Robbie had reached out, and we started to collaborate on content that the inevitably, we were going to turn into a third-party publisher in Haneda, and we started to bring content to the Xbox, and it all came together, I think, synergistically, and I think that the next few years, as we started to take off with Xbox Live and believed in this idea of online gaming and gaming together, there's still a little bit of a legacy of the Sega Dreamcast in there somewhere.
Well, so you bring up Xbox Live, and clearly, as I look at the industry and look at the innovation that, you know, this Xbox team brought to bear, it was with Xbox Live. And so, Robbie, why don't you speak to that a little bit in terms of, so, you know, how did you begin that vision? Because it cost money.
Yeah.
It made you lose money on the console, right, at the start. And then you had to continually think about, you know, where this online opportunity would be.
Well, I think, you know, for me to talk about, I'll just talk about what the team did, because, you know, this isn't, you know, I wasn't the visionary behind Xbox Live, and there were other people on the gaming side, Ed and Bonnie, Jay Allard and his team were super involved in thinking about Xbox Live. And my memory of that is how crazy people thought we were. I mean, literally, we had these tenants. We'd go out to publishers and we'd say, hey, guess what? You have to use voice in your game on Xbox Live. And then go, well, that'll never work. And then you go and say, oh, by the way, you can only have one gamer name. And it's the same gamer name no matter what game you're in. And they're like, no, I'm not gonna do that. And then we'd say, oh, but you have to register on a Microsoft server. That was like, seemed like a crazy idea. And of course, then what happens is Ubisoft comes out with a great game, Ghost Recon, on Xbox Live, and people go, oh my God, this is a game changer. And suddenly we're getting calls from people saying, I want to do that. And Ed's team did a great job on early games on Xbox of making Xbox Live a part of what they did. And so it started to build momentum. And suddenly, you know, we had dreams of having 10 million people on the service. And suddenly 10 million was like, oh, that's not hard. And it's just amazing how that evolved. And the vision, and I give the most of the credit to Jay and his team. There's other people who clearly were involved. But to be principled about it and say, we're going to produce a great experience online.
Yep. But to give credit where credit's due, I mean, there was a very important decision early on.
Fair point.
Which is
that's a great point.
Whether we're going to put a modem in the box
totally.
Or whether we're going to put an Ethernet port.
Yeah.
And the person who made that decision.
Yeah, who was it?
It was you.
Oh, yeah.
You were the one. It came up to you. I remember this very clearly. And you were like, nope. Modem, that's the pass. We're going to go with the Ethernet port.
Right, so there's a great meeting. We get to tell a few stories. So there's a great story that goes with us. We're in a meeting with Bill.
Oh,
and
yeah.
We've now made this decision. And I will tell you that the largest part, I wasn't making a technical decision. I was making a financial decision. We couldn't afford both.
Right.
And so we had to get rid of one or the other.
Yeah.
And it clearly made more sense to go with the future than it did with the past. But we're in
it wasn't clear because nobody had Ethernet in their house.
Nobody had broadband.
No one had
it. When we were talking about this, 80% of the world still connected via a telephone.
Absolutely.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So we're
this
in this
was not an easy decision.
I don't know if you were in this meeting, but we're in this meeting with Bill. And he says, and you know, this is a famous Bill quote, but he literally did say it in this meeting. That's the stupidest thing I've ever heard when we told him we were taking the 56K modem out.
Oh, I've never heard that before.
Yeah, I know, exactly. So we backed up and we said, okay, we're going to come and make the case to you. And there was a separate meeting and we went and made the case. And he said, I get it. Tell me how I can help with broadband. And Bill had a lot of connections in the telecom space, a lot of connections in the cable space. And he did do a lot of business development work for us to enable Xbox Live to get to that point.
Yeah, so you get some credit for that.
Yeah,
so one last question on this area, really, Bonnie, from your perspective. So again, you're making games, right? And you're seeing all of this unfold. You know, how did you see this opportunity? I mean, what was going through as you're looking to help produce these games? You know, what was the opportunity?
Well, the first game that I was working on for console was a party game. And I worked on Fusion Frenzy. And that was, so we were more focused on just launch on that. I would say what I thought was really interesting from the game side was when we first released Live, I think it was more of a novelty. You know, I think it was super cool where you could be talking and gaming with someone. Like, it was more just like a social thing where you were meeting someone across the world. And I think it was really just a fun novelty. And then I think that, and Ed could tell more on this, but Bungie really worked closely with the platform team to make Live what it is today. And I think that Halo 2 and everything just kind of propelled Live for where it is and the features. That was like a synergy of Bungie working with the platform team that really brought us to what we have today that I think then made it a must-have for everyone. And I don't know if
Reggie, we got to give a shout out though before Ed answers. Fusion Frenzy, my kids' favorite game. They still play Fusion Frenzy on any Xbox platform.
We really needed a game like that for launch.
And it's actually
I'm so glad the team came through.
Followed closely by Crimson Skies.
You're true.
Which I remember your son Philip playing.
He was a good Crimson Skies.
Met Commander, Crimson Skies. Mm-hmm. Those were some great live games from our group. But definitely the live team worked really closely with Bungie, even though Halo 2 was going to be a little bit farther out.
That means stuff
we don't want to talk about. But anyway, they did behind the scenes. They had a huge impact on the feature set and the UI and everything that went into Xbox Live.
That's great. Yeah. So let's pivot and let's talk about today and the things going on. And again, you know, some of you are still in the games business, right? Continuing to do interesting things. Obviously, Peter, yourself back into the games business. Ed is investing in the games business. I'm investing in the games business. So we've got a variety of different things going on. Robbie, you and I share connections as well, right? Writing books and giving speeches and board service. So let's talk about a little bit the here and now. And I'll start, Robbie, with you in terms of, you know, current activities, things right now that, again, tie back to the core tenet of creativity and innovation.
I think for me, the biggest legacy of my time on Xbox was actually discovering that someplace deep out inside, even though the team would hate to admit it, there was some creativity inside me. And I started, the team never would have guessed this, right? If you'd said, who would write a fiction novel? Nobody would have said Robbie Bach. But in fact, I wrote my first book, which was a nonfiction business strategy book, Xbox Revisited, and I decided I loved to write. And then I started to writing about characters, and I wrote 100 pages about characters with no plot. And then I said, oh, there's a plot here. And pretty soon I was writing a thriller. And now I published The Wilkes Insurrection, which is a really cool techno thriller with a little bit of political thriller elements thrown in. And, you know, my major character is a woman named Major Tamika Smith. And, you know, it's a great story about what's going on in our country set in a thriller context. And I discovered a side of myself that during my time in Xbox I didn't know existed. And it's this ability to come up with plot lines and themes and actually create characters that are live and real. And it made me realize how hard it is to create a great game. Because a great game has everything I just described and more. And so it's kind of gone full circle for me. And the book is, you know, obviously a joy, and I hope people take advantage and take a chance to read it. But it's been really cool to see that all come full circle.
Yeah, that's fantastic. You know, Peter, your story is interesting because, you know, you're in the games business doing wonderful things, and then you made a pivot to go back to a passion of yours, right? What the world knows as the beautiful game, and to do something really special there. So, and you've shared some of the creative things that that you did at Liverpool as part of that.
Yeah, I infamously got a call from an executive recruiter, which we've all got in our careers, and said, would you ever consider living back in England? I said, hell no. I'm kind of a California boy, and one thing led to another, and it was, what if it was to be the chief executive officer of Liverpool Football Club? And I'm born and bred in Liverpool. I first went to Anfield, our home stadium, in 1959. I was 4 years of age, and
Scouser.
These guys are, I'm a Scouser, yeah. And I went back 3.5 years there, and it couldn't have been a better three seasons as regards we were champions of the world, champions of Europe, champions of England. But more importantly, my job was to run the business of the football club. I had 800 full-time employees running that football club. And I applied so many video game lessons on fan engagement, utilization of technology. We have 400 million fans around the world. And it was no different than an Xbox Live, where you're trying to engage 24/7 hundreds of millions of people, keep the servers up, keep them engaged. And in the world of football, you only play once a week, twice a week for 90 minutes, but the fans want 24/7 content. I had an absolutely wonderful time there. And I thought I was going to come back and take it a little easy. And then John Riccitiello, as he's wont to do, shows me a little piece of what was gaming technology in the world of real-time 3D and said, look, I really believe that this has got unbelievable applications for sports and live entertainment, the virtualization, and finally bringing video game environments and visuals and control and interactivity into the real world. And I want you to come back and run that. We're still in lab stage and incubation, but we need somebody like you to do that. And lo and behold, there I am working full-time again. Yeah,
JR absolutely. Pulled you back in.
JR dragged me back in once again. one more crank of the reinvention wheel to see how I can do it. And it's a wonderful, wonderful company that just coincidentally today acquired Weta Digital, Peter Jackson's group, which wow. if you remember, we worked with Peter Jackson and I was on stage with Peter Jackson. Amazing how the world comes around.
Well, we worked with him to do some PR. It's not clear.
Built a warthog.
That's actually what I was saying. I want the warthog now that we're sitting here. Like,
drive around the 520 bridge, back? Yeah. So it's wonderful for me to get back in. You know, it's been a few years since I've been out of gaming, but it's great to get back in the saddle, and I'm thoroughly enjoying it.
That's great. And then, Ed, you're investing in the space and finding interesting ways to drive creativity that way.
I am, but mostly it still hasn't sunk in that after 20 years, Robbie finally figured out that what we did was hard. so I'm happy about that. So I do some board work. I'm on the board of the IGDA Foundation, which promotes diversity in the game business. I'm also on the board of the Smithsonian American Art Museum. And so I work with all these art people to try to convince them that the game world is important for art as well. My day job is running a venture fund called OneUp Ventures. Yeah. And really, we're about building a community of game developers. We connect the founders of 50 different game companies together through 50 investments so that they can all help each other and share and just increase the chance that the startups are going to be successful. That's been a lot of fun for me.
That's great.
Yeah.
And then Bonnie, no small task, right? You're leading one of the largest, arguably one of the most important of the studios for the Xbox team. And you got a little game that's going to be launching sometime soon. So, tell us, from what you're doing and how you're driving innovation with your team, how is that different? How is that the same as you've moved into your leadership position?
I would say a couple. Ed touched on diversity, and I think where you look at where we are with Xbox as well is really putting the player first, and the player is all of us. And how do we meet the player where they're at? So it's not just about the console anymore. It's really thinking about how do we make sure that the games they want to play and where they want to play it, they can do that. When you think about Halo and other games in our portfolio, it's also about, making sure that you have a diverse world and a diverse set of characters. And, we've recently done a lot of acquisitions of studios. I think we have 23 studios, which really is to try and have content, something for everyone. So for us, it's really about, having a diverse set of content, meeting players where they're at, and actually taking the, experience forward.
That's great. As you look to inspire creativity with your team and help them, get those next great games. I mean, how are you approaching it? How are you pushing that forward?
I think I'm not the creative maybe I'm going to go write a book after I leave too. But, I would say it's basically just making sure that the team has the ability to think about, I think with the nice thing we have with Xbox, there's so many different ways to think with the technology and how we're, meeting our players where they're at. I think that just it's really the team is, it's the team and just letting them know we have an amazing universe with Halo and there are hundreds of stories to tell.
Absolutely. Before we shift to talking about the future, you talk about diversity in gaming. Ed, one of the things that you're doing is you're really looking to push diversity from a creator standpoint, lead industry executive standpoint. Why don't you touch on that?
Yeah, well, I mean, like Bonnie said, the thing I love is that the game business, it arguably is now or will soon be the biggest media business in the world. And that kind of means that this term, gamer goes away, right? We're all gamers in a sense. And if you look at mobile games right now, more than half mobile game players are women. But who makes the content? Unfortunately, and there's still a small percentage of game makers, and that's just got to change. I mean, to create authentic content, it needs to come from people who, are like the audience, like Bonnie says. So that's important to us in 1UP, and especially early on when we were making our first investments, and because we're building a community, we wanted it to be a diverse community that reflects our audience. And so we went out of our way to make investments in diverse companies. And even to this day, we've made 36 investments. More than a third of them are female founder or co-founder. I think it's going to increase the chance that our fund is successful.
That's great. So we've talked a bit about the past, the present. Let's talk about the future. And as you think about the future of games, and yeah, games is by far the largest part of the entertainment space today. How does that continue to move forward? And Bonnie, from your perspective, as you think about creating world-class content, you know, where's the innovation going to go? Where do we go from here?
Yeah, I think there's so many different angles we could take here. One that I think is really important when you look at what technology is enabling is right now we're sitting here as the creators, but I think technology is opening up that everyone can be a creator. And I think that when I look at the future of entertainment, just like Ed's saying, we'll stop calling people gamers, I think that you'll have creators will not just be those of us sitting on this side. I think that really with, like for us, with Forge, you have, you know, Minecraft, you have the Forza livery stuff. Like you have creators, the users and the players are actually creating content they want to play. So I think it's like putting technology in the hands of the users to let them be the creators going forward. I think that's an interesting thing to think about for the future.
I agree. You know, Peter, from your perspective, right, you're incubating a technology platform. Yeah. And so, you know, how do you see continuing innovation, creativity, again, in this broad entertainment space?
Let me be the first to use the word meta.
Oh, don't go there. Don't go there.
Oh, wait. Come on. I called that during the prep.
I just think, to Bonnie's point, you know, our mantra at Uni is the world's a better place with more creators in it. And the acquisition today is validation of that, of trying to take the creative tools that Peter Jackson and his team did King Kong, did Lord of the Rings, and democratize that. And we believe there's already 2 billion creators, whether it's a TikTok or Instagram story, and people spending time taking either static images and videos and bringing them to life. We also believe that the world is going to break into real-time 3D. Everything in the world that I'm looking at is predicated on every sports broadcast in the future being broadcast concurrently in three dimensions. And so that a touchdown is scored, a slam dunk at the basket, a goal is scored, you immediately go and look on your Surface, hopefully, but on your
maybe
iPad.
Maybe on your Nintendo 3DS.
Yeah, whatever. and manipulate and look at it in three dimensions with 6 degrees of freedom. And that is the world that we see in the M word that we're all rolling into here. And it's for me personally, to be dropped back into that, you know, is invigorating, motivating, teaching old dog new tricks here. But it's to the point that everybody's making. And it's very clear to me that we're about to bring to life something that gamers have always taken for granted, which is going to replay mode in a sports game and spinning the cameras around because they're virtual cameras. And finally, we're bringing that to life in the real world.
Yeah. Robbie, how about from your perspective in terms of, you know, where's innovation and creativity going?
Well, for me, because I'm the least technical, Peter and I are probably the two least technical people here, but I may be the least technical person
since
here.
You started
the way
the
I'm thinking about creativity in the future is I'm thinking about how different forms of what we would have called separate entertainment. We would have said there was the music industry, the television industry, the movie industry, and the gaming industry. In the future, I don't think we're going to think about it that way. And as you get more people creating content, and then you start people saying, well, I love music and I like games. How do I put those two things together? I wanted to have music engaged in my book to playing in the background while you were reading it. And I couldn't do that, so fine. But that's going to happen. And so the idea that music and video and TV, real-time broadcasting, mm-hmm. that's all coming together. And I just think there's really cool opportunities for different types of content that we won't even know how to categorize. We won't know whether to call it a song or a game or a TV show.
Right.
And yet people will consume it and create it, as Bonnie says. And I think that's just a cool place for us to be. Yeah.
So we talked about the metaverse. Right? Yeah. So another hot term of the day. So AR versus VR, or both. What do you think is going to be the big win?
I think it's AR.
And why?
Because I think that VR completely, well, I think both, I guess I would say I love both. VR, you're totally escaping into a world. I think that AR will be more practical because it's a blending of worlds and blending of entertainment, kind of to what Robbie said. I think it kind of brings everything together and puts you in the presence and lets you also escape.
I agree. A discerning vote? Someone think that it's really going to be more in the VR space?
The other part of the business I'm working on is the virtualization of the entertainment experience. Mm-hmm. Live music concerts utilizing AR, VR, mixed reality.
Yep.
And, you know, I think about an industry that's ripe for disruption. It's live entertainment. It's still very much, if you're fortunate enough to get a ticket and Ticketmaster lets you have a ticket on their website, then you and maybe a couple of thousand people can crowd into an arena and watch something. And I think that there are millions that want to be there. And like sports, where we opened that up decades ago and watch it live on television, why can't we do that? And I think the ability to provide mixed reality experiences at home, if I want to watch the Foo Fighters and I want to bring that to life in my home, that's the type of stuff we're working on. And I think that is the future, which is the democratization of the entertainment experience. Again, it feels almost archaic that you've got to be fortunate to win a lottery to buy a ticket to travel somewhere, to pay $50 for a T-shirt and $15 for a beer, and then stand at the back and watch a big screen because you can't get close enough to the stage. I think all of that changes with technology, and I think all of that changes with the utilization of augmented reality. I'm with Bonnie. I'm a huge VR fan, but AR things pop into life. The Foo Fighters and Dave Grohl on your coffee table in your home and being able to interact and always have a front row ticket because you can.
Yeah. But why not both? What is a game at its heart? It's really the combination of software and entertainment. It's a new medium, and it's as important as plays were when they were invented, or music was.
I would agree if things go from helmet-ish to what we're seeing with glass right now.
But see, Peter, I think that's...
But what I'm trying to say, there's every time when there's this fight over, you know, like, I've been hearing for 30 years that PC gaming is dying. And no, it's not dying.
Nope.
It's
actually getting better. It's growing.
Right. And so it's not an either-or thing. We will have AR, we will have VR, you know? And our printers will play Doom.
I also think that more interesting distinction is what's going on in the hardware space, ironically, because I think there's sort of two different types of hardware that are being developed. There's what I'll call more consumer devices that are trying to get out of the helmet space, because the helmet space is not going to work as a consumer device. And then there are things that are going more hardcore in the business space, actually in the productivity space, where precision is going to matter a lot. And you may still see, and I think probably will see, the more detailed helmet space. And I agree with that. I think some of that's going to be virtual reality. You know, when you want to do a training situation, you may want that to be a virtual reality experience. And if you want to do a technician in the field, maybe that's an augmented reality situation. But I think the cool thing about this is you're going to see that technology in games. You're going to see it in television. Mm-hmm. You're going to see it in the office. And there's going to be tons of people. As a business guy, I look at it and say, wow, there's a lot of opportunity here.
Yep. There's a lot of white space.
There's a lot of space.
Yeah, and ultimately it's about us as human beings and how these things that we create affect ourselves and other people that we share them with. I mean, that's the core. I think that's something that Apple always did really well. It wasn't about the technology. The technology is a way to get to where we're headed.
Well, the build I would make there is I do think with all of these different technologies, content is going to drive it.
Oh, exactly.
Right? It's going to be the killer
content
app
drives hardware.
That's going to create this experience that people say, wow, right? I don't care that it's just a set of glasses, or I don't care that it fully encapsulates my head. I don't care. It's that this experience is just so compelling, and I'm enjoying it so much.
Hey, Reggie, I'll ask you a question, just to turn the tables. What do you think about the social implications of augmented reality and virtual reality? And I'd love to hear other people's point of view, because I think it has real implications. If somebody says, hey, I'm going to go to my metaverse, and now I've got this second life in a different world, I'm just trying to think through the social implications of that. And I think oftentimes in our industry, we create the experience, and then we try to clean up the social implications after the fact. And I'm just curious what you'd think about
that. Well, since you directed the question to me, I'll give my perspective. I do believe that this is where an AR-type experience, to me, is better socially because you're not completely away. You're not completely out of the real world experience. It's an overlay that's making it that much more enjoyable and adding value to the overall experience. So that's where I feel there's significant opportunity. I am concerned in an experience that completely takes you away from your family, the environment, all of those things. To me, that's a little bit more concerning socially.
Right.
And you know, part of this also, you know, my parental instincts kick in as well in terms of, you know, what would I rather see my kids doing and playing? Right.
I don't know. I created this crazy little company where you could print World of Warcraft statues.
Yeah.
You know, and you know what the number one thing people would do with them?
What?
They'd put them on their wedding cakes when they got married.
So who knows, right?
No. So I'm saying, you know, these are people, you know, hundreds, thousands of people playing in this world together. They meet the love of their life and they get married in the real world.
Sure, absolutely.
And when I think about my own two boys, you know, they have their real life friends and they have their friends that they can meet online.
Totally right.
Especially the last few years, the people who were more connected with their friends, you know, I think it had less impact.
I think, even though today in this panel, Peter's created the metaverse. I think that when we look at like the social responsibility, I think that when you look at it's not just one company. I think it's us thinking about what is social going forward. And I do think we as technology holders have a responsibility of really thinking about that social point and ethics in a way that we've never have before. And I think we're seeing it play out in front of us, what happens when we don't. And I think this is our second chance at that.
Yeah, and let's not forget the M word. The roots of that, when I arrived at Microsoft 18 years ago, Jay Allen throws a book at me, says, here, read that. Snow crash.
Snow crash, yeah.
Right? And that was because we were starting to think through what we wanted that entry point to Xbox Live be. And we went through, remember, lounges and all of the things we tried to do was this pseudo metaverse environment where you just entered. We ended up just very clean blades that just moved and got you in there very quickly. But it was, if you've read the book, it's a dystopian world. It's a dark place. And you Ready Player One, the same thing, Oasis Online. So I think what we're embarking upon, and you're exactly right, everything's going to have a digital twin. Everything will, this building, if it doesn't already, has a digital twin. At Unity, our growth is architecture, construction, automotive design, because we can put on VR helmets or in augmented reality, look at the plumbing of a building, design a car without clay anymore, which seemed to be the most primitive thing when you think about it, and move things around. And that steering wheel needs to be that shape and do that in virtual reality. And I think ultimately, you remember the movie Minority Report, the spatial web is coming. It's going to know Robbie's walking down the street. It's going to know what he wants, what he needs, what size he is, what his credit card number, God forbid, what his credit card number is. And it's going to react that way. And so I think all of us in the world of technology are obligated, to your point, to make sure that this is a safe, effective, economic place that we can all exist in. I don't buy the Zuckerberg, my avatar's wandering around somewhere, because you dropped in Second Life in your sentence, small s, small l, but remember what happened there, right?
I just flew in from Washington, D.C. last night, and one of the things I went out of my way on this trip to do was go see a memorial I'd never been to, which is the Teddy Roosevelt Memorial. And you have to go to this island, and you walk through these trails, and you get to this thing. And I'm he's there standing, you know, dramatically, and then there's a bunch of pillars behind him with quotes on it. And one of the quotes was about the balance between order and freedom, and it said that basically all freedom is bad and all order is bad, and that what we need to find a balance somewhere between those two. And that's, I think, exactly true for these technologies.
Exactly.
And if we create the metaverse, we need to keep that in mind, because they're still about people. And when you get people together, you know, you need to have a balance between those two things.
Exactly right.
Reggie, maybe we could wrap up with favorite memories in Xbox. This is the 20th anniversary year of Xbox. And maybe if we just went around the room and shared our favorite memory.
I think that's great. Let me
you
go
may have
first.
You may have a better ending.
No. I think that's great. But let me go first, because actually when Xbox launched, I wasn't in the industry.
Right.
So I was a consumer. And I was that prototypical consumer that had a PS2 in my house already, I had an N64. Mm-hmm. I was thinking about a GameCube, but I actually didn't buy a GameCube until I was already part of Nintendo.
We'll keep that
quiet. But my son, avid gamer, was the one saying, you know, we need to check out this Xbox thing. And we need to, you know, we need to go. And the driver was Halo. The driver was Halo. And that experience is what got the original Xbox into my house with that big old controller. So that is my Xbox memory from the very beginning.
That's cool. That's very cool.
Bonnie?
Well, first I want to be clear, like right now while I am running Halo, back then, you know, it was Bungie. And I do believe that the Xbox, I don't think you can separate them. And I think the success of both of them were because of Halo and Xbox at the same time. Mm-hmm. So at that time, as I said, I was working on Fusion Frenzy. And so I think that my best memory there is, and my team's claim to fame is, we were the first game to be certified ever to run go through cert for Xbox. We were the first game done. And again, I think we did all games back then. We all did them in like 18 months. I think we had less than 2 years to finish everything. So that was my team's best memory, to know that we were the first to go through cert, and we made it.
That's great. Peter? Favorite Xbox memory?
You got a lot.
I have hundreds. There's so many unbelievable moments I had in my years here. But I think, interestingly, the time that I spent with you, Robbie, with Bill in his office, talking about the strategy, listening to him expand upon why we were doing Xbox, why gaming was important to Microsoft, also telling him that there was no way we were going to put Microsoft branding on any of the products whatsoever. And in fact—
I'm sure that went over well.
Oh, wait, no, and to be fair, he understood it. You remember Robbie, the Time Magazine story that we did?
That's right.
Yeah,
that's a great memory.
Yeah, and I'm quoting there saying, look, we need to build our own brand. And whilst everybody understands, yes, this is Microsoft, and the power and the goodness of Microsoft that gets behind it from a platform perspective, particularly we were powering social gaming, interactive gaming, online gaming, and we couldn't have done that. We could not have done that if we weren't Microsoft. But those times I treasure. And the only time that I didn't treasure was when somebody has said to me, we need to take the NT servers down from some of our online casual games. And for some reason, it all reported to me. And because these NT servers were running on duct tape and baling wire. So I said, sure. Well, little did I know that the key game that they were going to take down was Bridge. And the next morning, I get a phone call from Bill, a phone call. Again, stupidest thing I've ever done in my life, apparently, was taking these servers down because these are the servers he used to play Bridge with Warren Buffett. And I guess he goes home in Medina that night, tries to log on, you know, back to Nebraska with Warren, and I had taken the servers down. So I heard about it the next day. But those were the moments that I treasure. So many great stories, so many funny stories. We could sit here for 6 hours and talk about E3. But I treasure that time, and with Steve Ballmer as well, one of my favorite people in this world. And so those are the moments I shall never forget.
Ed, how about for you?
Yeah, for me, it has to be the launch, you know, November 15th in New York City. And it was just the culmination of so much of this 2 year crazy journey to do the impossible, to pull all these software teams together, have the hardware and to have everything come together to be able to do this launch. But also, you got to remember that 9/11 happened just 2 months before, and the effect that that had on the whole country. And here we were right in the center of it in New York City and releasing this new thing into the world. And to me, it just felt like a fresh start. And I don't know, that it's just number one in my mind.
That's great.
Yeah.
Robbie, how about you?
Well, I go a little later than that. I go to the time when I knew we were going to survive and be successful. And I think some people thought that was launch or close after. I was looking at the P&L and wasn't so sure that that was going to be the case. But we got to an E3, I think it's 2004. And it's either I get confused about 2003 versus 2004. And we're backstage. Peter was there. Jay Allard was back there with me. And Muhammad Ali walks in.
Oh, yeah.
And you're backstage with the greatest. He's doing magic tricks.
Yep.
I have a picture where he took my fist, put it to his nose, and had the photographer come over and take the picture. And then you go out on stage. Electronic Arts had agreed to join Xbox Live. And you get this, and you know, Muhammad Ali comes on stage with a standing ovation. It's the only C3 I went to where I participated and there was anything good happening. So for me, that was just a sign. I walked away from that saying, okay, whatever happens, this team has created something pretty amazing. And that to me was a real achievement. And it really, everybody has this debate, who were the founders, who started Xbox, la, la, la. It was completely a team effort. And without a Bonnie, and without a Peter, without an Ed, without a me, a Jay, a Todd Holmdahl, tons of other people, it would have never happened. And that's the moment where to me it said, okay, this is real, we're on.
One added piece of color to that I may not have told you. I was sat off stage with Muhammad. My job was to keep him company for a little bit. And we had a screen and we were showing a Halo game. And I can't remember what it would have been, probably Halo 2-ish. Right. And a brute goes down. And if you recall, Muhammad at this point could barely speak, but he could whisper to you. And so I'm sat right here. And he was using magic tricks to communicate because his Parkinson's was so advanced and he loved to do it and he got a reaction from people. But when he's watching this screen and you and Don Matrick and everybody are out there on the stage, he leans into me and goes, "Down goes Frasier." And I will never forget that moment.
That's a pretty good one.
You've got to be a certain age to remember Howard Cosell, but he whispers in, "Down goes Frasier." And I'm going, did I just hear that?
Wow.
And,
cool.
And that was Muhammad. And then he came on stage and he was pretty frail, but we got him there. What a moment that was.
That's a great
incredible moment.
Well, what a wonderful story. What a wonderful way to conclude this panel. So I want to thank you all for the participation. I want to thank you for the opportunity for a non-Xbox person to be part of this. You know, the moment in time of the launch, the moment in time now, 20 years later, you know, the industry is better because of the Xbox launch. I passionately believe that. And the fact that there are all of these companies making all of this wonderful content, the ecosystem is so robust. Xbox is a big part of that. So thank you for the opportunity to participate. Thank the viewers who are watching this and the Xbox community, and it's been wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you, Reggie.
Thank you.
It's Reggie.